Colossians chapter 3, we're going to begin reading in verse 1, just three verses here, and then we'll get into the word. Colossians chapter 3, beginning in verse 1. If you then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sits on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth. For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. I want to read those three verses just one more time. If you then be risen with Christ, so this is Paul saying, if it is true, this is what Paul is saying, if it's true that you have been risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sits on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above and not on things of the earth. For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. This passage of Scripture is, of course, as we know, the Apostle Paul writing to the church at Colossae. The church at Colossae at this time was pastored by a man named Epaphras. And Epaphras most likely was saved under the ministry of the Apostle Paul when the Apostle Paul made his journey into Ephesus in Acts chapter 19. Whenever Paul heard of the disciples in Ephesus who had, yes, they had been saved. Yes, they had believed in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. For the Bible tells us that when he came to them, they said, you know, the only thing that we know is the gospel of John. John the Baptist, that's the gospel we believe. We have held fast to the Messiah. We've held fast to the Lamb of God who was slain from before the foundations of the world. But what they had not yet heard about was the baptism with the Holy Spirit. And I may be speaking on that tonight, but for now, for where we are now, the Apostle Paul came to them and said, have you yet received the Holy Spirit? And they said, we've not even heard of such a thing. We've never heard that there is a Holy Spirit that we can be baptized into or that we can be baptized with. And it's very probable that Epaphras, the pastor of the church of Colossae now in the early AD 60s, it's very possible that Epaphras was one of those few, one of those men, one of those women who were there listening to the Apostle Paul preach about the baptism with the Holy Spirit. And not only did the Apostle Paul there preach about the baptism with the Holy Spirit, but the church at Ephesus, when Paul made his way there into Macedonia, Ephesus right before Macedonia, when he made his way there, the Bible says that many miracles were wrought by the hand of the Apostle Paul, that God wrought special miracles through the hand of the Apostle Paul. Amen. So it's most likely that Epaphras had heard about the baptism with the Holy Spirit. He heard about the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Not only did he hear about it, but he experienced it firsthand, because it's very probable that he was there baptized with the Holy Spirit, and it's very probable that he's seen the Apostle Paul work under the unction and the anointing of the Holy Spirit to see sick and bodies healed, to see those who were possessed with demons cast out, to see those who were bound by sin, bound by the vices of this world, set free by the power of God. It's very possible that Epaphras saw all of this happen, but what's the most important thing that Epaphras heard, that Epaphras saw from the Apostle Paul, was that he heard the truth of the gospel. He's seen miracles, he's seen people baptized with the Holy Spirit, but the most vital thing, the most important thing that Epaphras experienced there in Ephesus when Paul made his journey there was that he heard the truth of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. He heard about the blood of Jesus. He heard that the blood of Jesus was not just for our initial salvation, but that it was for our everyday life and living. He heard that the blood of Jesus was what was given to us to give us power over sin, to give us power over the powers of darkness, to heal us from sicknesses and diseases, to set us free from the bondages and vices of sin and the vices of this world. That's what Epaphras heard. And that's what that was the most important part of Epaphras getting saved under the Apostle Paul's ministry, was that he heard the truth of the gospel. And some 20 years later, some 15 years later, we find Epaphras he's not any longer just a brand new born-again Christian, but now he's pastoring. He has founded a church in the area of Colossae. And after he's pastoring there for some 5, 10, 15, we really don't know the exact amount of time, but after he's pastoring there for a time, Judaizers and Gnostics begin to come into the church there. They begin to creep into the church and they begin to try to sow discord in the church. They try to begin telling the church that, you know, the gospel that Epaphras is preaching to you is not really the truth of the gospel. You've got to move on to something else. You've got to do something else. And you can read about that in Colossians chapter 2 whenever he would tell them, don't let anyone remove you from the gospel that you've been placed into. Don't be deceived by these philosophies and vain deceits that are trying to be preached to you. And much like the church of Jesus Christ today, we have a form of godliness, but we're denying the power thereof because we're not preaching the message in which resides the power.
Amen.
That's why we don't have power like we had at one time, is because the church has strayed away from the message, from the object of faith that provides us with the power that we have need of.
Amen.
And that's what was going on at the church of Colossae. This young pastor Epaphras, he sees all of this going on, conflict coming into his church, conflict coming into the people of God, not really knowing what to do, not really knowing where to go, but he knew something. He knew deep down in his heart that what he heard the first time that he got saved, what he heard the first time he got baptized with the Holy Spirit, was enough to keep this church going and operating under the power of Almighty God. He knew that. So Epaphras would make a journey of some 1,000 miles. Think of that. Some 1,000 miles Epaphras would travel from Colossae to where Paul was imprisoned in Rome. He would travel. For what reason? What purpose? What's the point just to go and talk to the Apostle Paul for a couple of days? It's because he wanted to hear the truth.
Amen.
One more time.
Amen.
It's very possible that that church at Colossae was on the cusp of being destroyed. They were on the cusp of being overrun by the powers of darkness because of false doctrine that was creeping into the church. But Epaphras said, no, I'm not going to let that happen. I need to hear the truth. I need to be encouraged by this gospel just one more time. And Epaphras would travel, like I said, some 1,000 miles to where Paul was sitting in a Roman cell. And he would say, Paul, and I heard our professor, Brother Larson, he says it like this, that Epaphras, he came to Paul in that Roman cell and he said, Paul, just tell me the truth just one more time.
Amen. Yes.
Just one more time, encourage me in the truth of the God. Just one more time, tell me about Christ and what he's done for me at the cross. Just tell me about it, Paul. I've got a church who they're lackadaisical. I got a church they're being destroyed by false doctrine. I've got a church they're being swept up by the power of the enemy. Paul, I need to be encouraged. Paul, I need to be strengthened. And that's where this letter comes from, the letter of Colossae, the letter of Colossians. It comes from Epaphras coming to Paul and saying, Paul, we need an answer. We need something, Paul. And you know what Paul did? Paul gave him the gospel again. Mm-hmm. Paul brought him back to Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And what Christ had done at Calvary's cross. And I want to minister a message this morning, simply entitled, taken from our text, Colossians chapter 3 and verse 1, seek those things which are above. Seek those things which are above. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, Lord, and we do so in the name of your Son, Jesus, Lord. We thank you for this opportunity you've given us to preach your word, to teach your word. And Father, we ask, Lord, that you would only anoint us, Lord, to speak that which you would have us to say, Lord. Anoint my mind and my heart. Anoint my tongues and my lip, Lord God, that I might proclaim, Lord, your glorious gospel as you would see fit. Lord, I realize that in and of myself this morning, I don't have what it takes, Lord God. I don't have what it takes in and of myself to minister your word, but I know that by your anointing and by your grace, Lord, someone can be edified, someone can be strengthened, someone can be baptized with the Holy Spirit, somebody can be touched by your gospel, Lord, because it's no one else's gospel but your gospel. And we thank you for it this morning, and we'll be sure when it's all said and done, as we do now, to give you the praise, the honor and the glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Paul would open up this letter to the church at Colossae like we were talking about. And he would begin, as we said, to once again lay down the foundations of the message of the cross. He would begin to lay down the whatever you want to call it, the message of the cross, the truth of the gospel. It's all the same thing, whatever you want to label it as. One's just the same as the other. So Paul would begin to label. He would begin to lay out the foundation of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ again. And he would begin to encourage the church at Colossae. And I can only imagine that because of the lack of truth, because of the false doctrine that was creeping into the church at Colossae, that these believers more than likely had possibly become lackadaisical in their walk with God. They had possibly become complacent in their walk with God. And I know for myself, I come in contact with a lot of Christians who they claim to know the message of the cross. They claim to believe the gospel. They claim to to say, well, I believe Jesus. They're quick to say, you know, I believe Jesus Christ for my salvation. They're quick to say that, yes, I'm saved, yes, I'm going to heaven, but I see no pursuit of righteousness in their life. I see no pursuit of holiness in their life. I see no fire within their hearts and within their lives to pursue after the call of God, to pursue really after the purpose of God. And I'm afraid this morning that the reason for that on a large scale, not every aspect, but on a large scale, the reason for that is because they're not knowledgeable. They don't really know what the gospel entails. They're ignorant of the mystery of the gospel. They're ignorant of the truths of the gospel. They're ignorant of their position in Christ. They're ignorant of what happened, what truly happened whenever they said yes to Jesus. Because let me tell you something. When you start to find out, when you start to figure out what happened to you when you said yes to Jesus, it's going to light a fire down in your soul, like Brother Sam was singing about this morning. It's going to light a fire within you that's going to cause you to say, I want to pursue after holiness. I want to pursue after righteousness. I want to pursue after the fact of being made free from sin, being made free from the things of this world. I don't want to be like the world anymore because I'm not my own any longer.
Yes.
Me and Brother Robert were talking about it last night at the dinner table about the same subject, and he made a statement that really, because like I said, over the past several weeks, I've been having this burning and this desire within my heart, and the Lord has just reignited a flame, a spark in my heart, to where I want to pursue after the righteousness of God. I want to pursue after the holiness of God. I want to be set apart unto God and His way. I want to be set apart unto the holy calling of God, unto the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. I want to pursue after it. And God is lighting a flame in my heart to do that more and more. And I know at times we can take that desire, we can take that zealousness, and we can turn it into self-righteousness because we can look around and say, well, you're not doing what I'm doing, and you're not being what I am, and you're not like me, and you don't say it like I say it, and you don't do it like I do it. But it's not about that. The fire that comes from the Spirit of God to cause you to pursue after righteousness, to cause you to seek those things which are above, it's a fire that cannot be ignited in and of yourself. It's not something that you can just wake up one morning and decide, man, I'm going to have a fire today. You know, I'm going to get on fire for Jesus. You'll do that, but it won't last very long. You can try to do that and wake up, man, I'm just going to be zealous for Jesus. No, it's got to be a work of the Spirit. It has to be a work of the Spirit within your heart. And how that comes about is by us hearing the truth of the gospel, us hearing what happened to us when we said, us hearing about who Jesus is and what Jesus has done. Romans chapter 10, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Galatians chapter 5, faith works by love. So as I hear about the love of God, as I hear about the love of Jesus Christ, which was demonstrated on Calvary's cross, for that was the purpose that Christ came into the world, to save sinners. That was the purpose that Jesus came. That was where God demonstrated His love, was at Calvary. So as I hear about the love of God, as I hear the word of the cross, as I hear about the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, now the Spirit of God begins to stir my spirit, my inner man, my human spirit, my heart. He stirs me to begin to believe Him for greater things. He stirs me to begin to believe Him for what I don't have. He stirs me to begin to believe Him that, God, I understand that I'm this way, but I do believe that tomorrow I can wake up and be a changed man by the power of Your Spirit. Not because of anything that I do, Not because of what you've done and what you're doing on the inside of me. That's what Philippians chapter 2 says. For it is God that works in you, both to will and to do of his good pleasure. So if you have a desire in your heart to serve God, to follow after God, to pursue after righteousness, pursue after holiness, that desire did not come about by you. That came about by the Spirit of God. If there's any desire on the inside of you that wants to serve God, that wants to live for God, that wants to strive after the things of God, it's all been birthed by the Spirit of God. So how does that grow? How does that cause us to be a people who want to seek things which are above? How does that cause us, what causes us to want to continue to pursue that? What causes that? It's the first two chapters of Colossians. It's the foundation of the gospel. That's what ignites the flame, and that's what keeps the flame going. Man, that's good. That's what ignites the flame. That's what starts the zealousness in my heart. That's what starts the desire in my heart, and that's what keeps the flame burning. That's what keeps the flame going. That's what Paul said in Colossians 2 and 6. We'll get to it in a moment. In a moment, as you have therefore received Christ Jesus the Lord, so ye walk in him, rooted and built up, established in what? In the faith. Not established in what I can do or what I can't do. Not established in where I go or where I don't go. No. If I'm planted, if I'm established in the gospel that I've been taught, in the gospel that I've been given, if I'm rooted, if I'm grounded, if I'm established in the faith of the gospel, then the fire that began in me is not going to run out. The fire that God started on the inside of me, it's not going. Sometimes it might seem like it ran out. Sometimes it seems like it might dwindle a little bit, but I can promise you that God is going to continue to light that flame until the day of Jesus Christ. That's what Paul said in Philippians 1 and 6, to be confident of this very thing, that he which has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. You can rest assured, you can be sure this morning that if you have a flame, or even if there was a flame in your heart at one time in your life, and you say, well, I really don't feel it anymore, I really don't sense it anymore, I really don't, I don't have the desire and the passion and the power like I had at one time. Maybe that's you this morning. Maybe that's how you feel this morning, that I don't have that fire, I don't have that passion. Well, get in the Word of God and start to read about what Jesus Christ has done for you. Get on your knees and say, God, I'm not coming to you presenting to you my own works. I'm not coming to you presenting to you what I can or what I can't do. God, I'm coming to you and asking you to give me a revelation of Jesus Christ and what he does for me. That's what God the Holy Ghost is wanting you to do, is to ask him for a greater revelation. Ephesians chapter 1, that your eyes would be open, that your mind, that your heart would be enlightened to the mystery of the gospel. Yeah. As human beings, without God, we're blind. We don't know anything about God. There's a lot of theologians all around the world who can quote this Bible from beginning to end, from Genesis to Revelation. They can quote the Word of God. They can tell you scriptures. They can quote the entire book of this and that and the other, but they don't have a revelation of the Spirit of God. There's a difference between a head knowledge and having a revelation of the Spirit of God. And some of us have a head knowledge, but we need God the Holy Ghost to make that head knowledge a part of our everyday life and living. Knowing the message of the cross, knowing the truth of the gospel up here is not enough. It's not going to suffice in the day and hour in which we are living, when times are getting harder than they've ever been, when persecution against Christians, persecution against believers are rising up everywhere we look. We look left and right and up and down, and everywhere you look, it's persecution against Christians. Your complacent Christianity is not going to work in the day and hour in which we live. Say that in a condemning way. I say that in the sense that if you are complacent, if you are in a place to where, God, I don't know what's going on, God, I don't feel your presence. If you are in that place, I'm here to tell you that God can light a fire on the inside of you that will cause you to seek after the kingdom of God, that will cause you to seek after the righteousness of God, that will cause you to seek after the purity and the holiness of God. He can do it on the inside of you. God is faithful. God is faithful. He is he who has called you, he's also faithful to complete the work that he started in you. He's faithful to do it. I know I was telling Brother Robert last night, over the past couple months, I felt like That fire was just dwindling. The desire was dwindling. And I was a lot of times very confused and discouraged. God, what's going on in my eye? I don't understand. But you know what? When I laid my head down at night, you know, in the natural, it didn't look like I had a desire of God. I wasn't reading my Bible as much. I wasn't praying as much. I wasn't doing this as much and that as much. But on the inside of me, In the very inner recesses of my heart, there was a desire that said, God, I don't want to quit. God, I want that fire again. God, light me on fire again. God, give me a greater hunger. God, give me a greater desire. I don't say what I'm saying this morning to condemn anyone, because as Romans 8:1 says, there's no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. I'm not talking about those of you who are struggling, those of us who are struggling in certain areas and aspects of our life. That's not what I'm talking about, because God knows your heart. God sees that you have a heart that is burning and desiring and longing after Him. But I'm talking about if you've grown complacent, if you've grown to a place to where, yeah, I know the gospel and that's good enough. I run into a lot of people like that. They'll talk the talk, but they're not walking the walk. They talk the talk. They'll talk about Jesus. They'll talk about the message. I know just these past couple of weeks I've ran into people even at work at times. And, you know, they'll be quick to say, yes, you know, I love Jesus. Yes, I'm saved. But their lives have nothing to do with the Lord Jesus Christ. Their lives are full of immorality, partying, drinking, and it seems as if there's no conviction. Am I saying they're not saved? No, that's not up to me to say that. That's between them and God. Amen. But what I will say is that the way that they are living is not the way that God desires for them to be living. God desires His people, those of us who claim to know Jesus Christ, those of us who claim to be in a vital union and relationship with Him. It's not about, oh, well, you're a pastor, so you need to pursue righteousness more than I do. Oh, well, you're a preacher, so you need to be more consecrated and dedicated than I am. No, it's not about that. The Bible doesn't say that. The Bible labels and addresses Christians. The Bible doesn't label and address certain, at times it does. But as it regards walking with the Lord, as it regards pursuing after the call of God, as it regards pursuing after the righteousness of God, the Bible doesn't single one or two out. No, He says that all of you need to pursue after the call of God, the high calling of God that is in Christ Jesus. Every single man, woman, boy, and girl that claims the name of Jesus, their lives should be portraying the image of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
We're lights in a darkened world. We're salt in a filthy earth. That's what we're called to be. It's easy to profess out of our mouths. It's easy to tell people, oh yeah, I'm a Christian. It's easy to, in church, you know, it's easy to act like we're Christians, to act like we're this and act like we're that. It's easy. How do I know? Because I've done it. And I still do it at times. We put on a face, we put on a facade, and we walk into church like, man, everything's going good. Man, I'm just on fire for God because I get in church and I can lift my hands and I can clap. But as soon as I walk out of the church door, all hell's breaking loose and I don't want to admit it because I'm too stubborn. I'm too self-righteous. I don't want people to know that I'm in a battle. I don't care who you are. I don't care where you're from. It doesn't matter what position that God has called you to be in. If you are truly pursuing after the righteousness of God, if you're truly seeking those things which are above, the things that God requires and asks of us to seek, if you're truly doing that, you are in a fight. There's no denying it. There's no getting around it. You are in a fight. And it's the fight for your life. Because the enemy, he doesn't want your goods. He doesn't want this, that, and the other. What he wants is your life. And what he is trying to steal from you is your faith. Because if he can take your faith away from you, then he can take your life. If he can take your faith, then he can strip you of your life. Because your faith is your life, because the faith that you believe, if you're truly believing in Christ and what He's done at the cross, that faith is really not your own anyway. Paul would say in Galatians 2:20 that I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live, yet not I, but Christ who lives in me. And the life which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. So the faith that I'm believing, the faith that I'm pursuing, the faith that I have in Christ and what He's done at the cross is not even a faith that I've come up with in my own mind. There's a lot of people in this world that have faith in a lot of things. A lot of folk in church, in so-called Christian churches who have faith in a lot of things. But God only honors one type of faith. God only honors one object of faith. God only honors one aspect of faith, and that is the plan. That is the faith that He has instituted from before the beginning of time. As Peter would say in 1 Peter chapter 1, that from before the foundations of the world, Christ was crucified. That He would redeem you, not with corruptible things such as silver and gold, but with the precious blood of the Lamb. It's the faith of Christ and what He's done at the cross. 1 Corinthians chapter 1. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness, but unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. Amen. That word power is dynamo. It means it's dynamite, it's power, it's miracle working power in my life.
Yes. Yes.
Well, if I claim this message, if I claim the message of the cross, if I claim to know the power of God, then why isn't my life living up to it? Why is my life, why is the things that I do, the places that I go, the way that I act, why are they contrary to what I claim to believe? Why? It's all over the place. Like I said, and I'm not saying anybody's perfect. None of us will ever arrive or attain to a place of perfection, a place of where we so-called need to be. But we're supposed to be in a race. We're supposed to be pursuing something. We're supposed to be looking for something. That's why Paul said in Philippians 3, he said, all those things that were before, he said, I count all that as dung for the sole purpose that I may know Him. That I may know the Lord Jesus Christ in the power of His resurrection and the fellowship of His sufferings. That means that I'm coming into a vital union, a vital one-on-one relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Seek those things which are above where Christ sits at the right hand of God. Seek those things. Follow after those things. Pursue after those things. Well, what is it that's going to cause me to pursue after that, Paul? We start in Colossians 3 and verse 1, and it's kind of like Paul starting a whole new book. But if that was the case, we wouldn't really know how to seek after those things. We wouldn't know why we want to seek after those things, and whatever the case, if Colossians just started in chapter 3 and verse 1. But I thank God that there were two chapters before Colossians chapter 3 and verse 1 where the Apostle Paul would lay out the reason as to why we need to seek those things which are above. That he would lay out the purpose, he would lay out the design as to so that we could understand why our hearts yearn for more of Jesus, why our hearts need and desire more of Jesus. And in chapter 1, verse 6, Paul would begin to show us the first reason. He said, and all these things, it's all Paul leading up to chapter 3 to tell us to seek those things which are above. Because you're dead and your life is hid with Christ and God. So if I'm to pursue after that, well, what is it that I'm seeking after? I'm seeking after righteousness. Because that's where Christ is. That's what Christ is. He's righteousness. He's holiness. Seek those things which are above. Seek after the kingdom of God. So I'm to be seeking after righteousness. I'm to be seeking after holiness. I'm to be seeking after purity. I'm to be seeking after power. All of those things that involve themselves with Christ and all those things that Christ are, that's what I'm supposed to be longing after, seeking after. So what is it that causes me to seek after that? Or rather, what is it that gives me the ability? I think that's better. What is it that gives me the ability or the availability to seek after righteousness, to seek after holiness, to seek after the power of God, to seek after those things that God desires me to be? Because after those first three verses in Colossians 3 and the rest of the chapter, Paul begins to tell us, if you're claiming this gospel, then you need to be living like it, is what Paul said. I'm paraphrasing, but that's what Paul's saying. You need to put off those things that concern the old man. Put off lying. Put off blasphemy. Put off malice and envyings and disputings and fornication and uncleanliness. And all these things, you need to put them off.
Yep. Amen.
So if Paul's writing to a church of believers telling them that they need to put off these things, then that tells me there's a possibility that I can be a Christian and yet not portraying the image of Christ. I can be saved. I can be saved and make it to heaven, just barely make it into heaven, but on this earth my life was not portraying the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. On this earth my life was not portraying the light of the world. My life was not being the salt of the earth. I can make it to heaven, but my life has no righteousness, no purity, holiness proceeding from it. This is what gives us the availability to seek those things, or gives us the power, or really brings those things to us. Chapter 1 and verse 6, Paul would remind us as he's writing to the church at Colossae, speaking to Epaphras, here in a Roman jail, said, man, I love. Paul's always in prison, but yet every time he's in prison, he's writing the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Just like in the book of Philippians, he's in prison in either Caesarea or Rome, and yet the theme of the book of Philippians is joy. Joy, 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 joy. Rejoice in the Lord. He's chained to a Roman guard, but yet he's telling the church at Philippi to rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice, and this is why, because Paul knew this. And he wanted to remind Epaphras that the gospel, chapter 1 and verse 6, it continually brings forth fruit in your heart and in your life. From the day that you believed the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, if you've continually placed your faith solely and completely in Jesus Christ and what He's done at the cross, then I can promise you that some fruit has been coming forth from your heart and from your life. And if you're just starting today, you say, well, this is the first day that I've started on this journey, well then buckle your seatbelt and get ready, because you're going to watch the power of the Holy Spirit bring forth fruit in your heart and in your life. That's good news. From the very moment that you say yes to Jesus, God the Holy Ghost has gone to work in the inner recesses of your heart, and He started a work in you that no demon in hell, no fallen angel, no preacher, no backslidden Christian can stop you from pursuing. The gospel brings forth fruit in the heart and life of the believer. It doesn't matter who you are, how old you are, where you're from, what you've done. It doesn't matter. You've been forgiven. And now the power of the Holy Spirit has taken up residence within your heart and within your life. And now He's going to begin to bear fruit. He's going to begin to produce fruit in your heart and in your life. Amen. You're going to wake up tomorrow morning and you're going to say, man, I've been doing this and I've been saying this, that, and the other, but God, the Holy Ghost tells me I need to stop that stuff. I'm not talking about law. I'm talking about what the Holy Ghost does with the new creation in Christ Jesus. If you said yes to Jesus, if you said yes to Jesus, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, you've become a new creation in Christ Jesus. Old things have passed away and all things are become new. You're a new creation in Christ Jesus. And now the Holy Spirit has the availability. He has you've given him access, and He has given you access for His Spirit to come in, reside on the inside of you, and to begin to produce Jesus Christ on the inside of your heart.
Thank you, Lord.
This is a never-ending process. The fruit bearing of the believer. It's the Holy Spirit that produces the fruit. I just bear the fruit. I cannot produce the image of Jesus Christ in and of myself. I can't do it. But I have a factory, a new factory on the inside of me that day by day is producing new items, that's producing new product, that's producing new gifts, that's producing new things every single day of my life. And all I have to do is simply allow it to take place. I don't have to force it to take place. I don't have to try to do this, that, and the other in order that the fruit of God might be born in my life. I don't have to. I just have to allow it. How do I allow? I allow it by faith. Because Paul said, it's the gospel that brings forth fruit in you. Chapter 1, verse 6. It's the gospel that brings forth fruit in you. It's not you that brings forth fruit. It's the gospel. If there's anything good or godly about you in your heart and in your life, it was not and has not been produced by you in your self-effort. It's not been produced by how much you've read, how much you've prayed, how much you've fasted. All those things are good. But that's not what produces the fruit of God in your life. What produces the fruit of God in your life is the power of the Holy Spirit having access, having availability to move and to work and to operate in your heart and in your life. It's the gospel that brings forth fruit in your life. Chapter 1, verse 9. What else does the gospel do? It fills us with the knowledge of His will. And all wisdom and spiritual understanding and wisdom really is Christ and what He's done at the cross, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 1, that the wisdom of God is the cross. The world thought it foolishness. The world labeled it as foolishness, but God says it doesn't matter what they label as foolishness, because this is my wisdom. This is my power. This is everything that I have for humanity. Everything that's good about me was displayed and given to man through the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the gospel, the power of the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, He fills us with the knowledge of His will. I know, I've heard one of my professors say it like this: I know the will of God for every single born again, blood bought believer that's ever walked the face of this earth. The general will of God for every single one. Mm-hmm. And that is that you be conformed into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise God.
I don't care if you're a pastor, I don't care if you're a layman, I don't care if you work in a plant, I don't care if you work at a grocery store, it doesn't matter. The will of God for your life is that you be sanctified, that you be changed, that you be formed and molded into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. So the Spirit of God, if the gospel of the Spirit of God gives us the knowledge of His will, He's going to be telling us, you need to pursue after righteousness. You need to pursue after holiness. You need to pursue after all these things. But there's only one way that we can pursue after it, and it's the same way that we've received it. And it's through the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We can pursue after the Lord Jesus Christ because we've been brought in by the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't seek the Lord Jesus Christ unless you've been found by the Lord Jesus Christ. If you want to find Him, He's got to find you first. He's not the ones that was lost, you were.
Yep.
He found you, and now He's given you the availability to seek after His will, to seek after His purpose, to seek after His plan and His desire for your life. So the gospel, chapter 1 and verse 9, fills us with the knowledge of His will and all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Chapter 1 and verse 12, He has made us meet. He has literally made us qualified to be partakers of His inheritance, which is really the inheritance of the saint. The inheritance of God. Everything that God has in glory, everything that heaven has to offer is in Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And guess what? When I said yes to Jesus, God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, plucked me up out of the kingdom of darkness and placed me into the kingdom of His dear Son. So that tells me that everything that heaven has to offer is now mine. Do you get what I'm saying? Everything that heaven has to offer is now blessings and riches and power and wisdom and all of those things I can have because I am placed, I am given an inheritance. Because the inheritance of the Lord Jesus Christ is the inheritance, as He says here, of the saints. Saints of God, those of us who are washed in the blood of the Lamb. Saints are not like what the Catholics call saints. They pray to this saint and that saint and everything else. That's not a saint of God. A saint of God is simply someone who has said yes to Jesus Christ. Somebody who has been washed and forgiven by the power of the blood of Jesus. That's a saint. That's what qualifies you to be a saint of God. I'm a saint of God this morning. Not because of what I've done. Not because I performed good enough. Not because I did that, this, and the other. No, because I said yes to Jesus Christ. I'm a saint, and now God brings me in to His heavenly inheritance.
Yes.
Because my old man's dead, and my new life, Colossians 3 and 3, my new life is hid with Christ in God.
Amen.
Verse 13. He has delivered us. He's literally drawn us up. He snatched us. He rescued us from danger. He has delivered us, verse 13, from the power of darkness and translated us into the kingdom of His dear Son. That word deliver, like I said, it literally means to draw or snatch up, to rescue from danger.
Mm-hmm.
Brother Robert, He rescued us from danger.
Yes.
Not only did He rescue me from danger, He rescued me from the kingdom of darkness, the power of darkness. I was ruled, I was powered, empowered, overpowered, everything powered by sin, the devil, demons, and hell. I was powered and overpowered by those things. But when I said yes to Jesus, not when I prayed for a year, not when I fasted for 3 months. No, when I said yes to Jesus, God, the power of the Holy Ghost, plucked me up out of that kingdom, a kingdom that was ruled by sin, Satan, and the world. Plucked me up out of that kingdom and placed me into the kingdom of His dear Son. Placed me into the kingdom of righteousness. Placed me into the kingdom of holiness. Placed me into the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm an heir with God and a joint heir with the Lord Jesus Christ. Whatever God has given to Jesus is now mine. Not because I am Jesus, but because I'm in Jesus and Jesus is in me.
Amen.
It's not because I'm a little God. No, it's because I've been placed into God. It's because God has taken up residence on the inside of me, and now everything that's His is mine.
Yes.
Everything.
Amen.
The day, the moment, the hour, the second that I said yes to Jesus, that very moment, everything that was God's in heaven's now becomes mine, because He's given me an inheritance. That's good stuff.
Amen.
Verse 14, we have redemption through His blood, even the forgiveness of sins. Paul, once again, reminding Epaphras, reminding the church at Colossae, don't forget you have redemption through His blood. You have the forgiveness of sins. Don't worry about what you did yesterday. Yesterday is gone. There's a song we sing, Brother Sam, I know you know it. Yesterday is gone. Today, I'm in need of Holy Ghost power. Move on me. Don't worry about what you did yesterday. Don't worry about what you did an hour ago. If you said, Lord, forgive me of my sin, that thing is cast as far as the east is from the west. God doesn't even remember the sin that you were involved in. He doesn't even remember the mistake that you made yesterday. He doesn't even remember the thought that you had this morning. If you'll simply let it go, give it to Him and say, God, wash it in the blood of the Lamb. If you do that, you now receive the forgiveness of sins. It doesn't matter how bad you failed, what you've done, it doesn't matter anymore. You've received redemption through His blood. You've received forgiveness through His blood. Verse 20, He has made peace for us through the blood of His cross, that by this thing He could reconcile all things unto Himself, having made peace through the blood of His cross, by Him to reconcile all things unto Himself. You and I, before we said yes to Jesus, were enemies of God. God could not, He could not reside within us, and we could not reside in the presence of God. It couldn't happen. We were enemies. We were strangers. We didn't know God from Adam. We didn't know anything about God. We couldn't be in God's prayer. We couldn't do for God. We couldn't act for God. We couldn't be righteous. We couldn't be holy. But when we said yes to Jesus, when Christ, through the power of what He did at Calvary's cross, shed His blood, He literally made peace through that event.
Mm.
Not just peace as in the sense of a peace of mind. Mm-hmm. No, I'm talking about peace to where God can now look at me and say, I see no iniquity in this man, nor perverseness in this man. I'm talking about peace that says I was once an enemy, I was once a foe, but now I've become a friend. I was once outside of the box, or I was once outside of the kingdom, and now I've been placed into the kingdom. Peace with God. Peace with God.
Amen.
How did Christ do that? He did it through the event of the cross.
Amen.
The Bible says it here. Don't look at me like I'm crazy. That's what the Bible says.
Mm-hmm.
That He made peace with God. He's given us peace, access to God through the blood of His cross. That He might reconcile, that He might literally bring us back together in right relationship with God.
Mm-hmm.
Verse 21 and 22. We were sometime, we were alienated, like I was just talking about. We were enemies in your own mind by wicked words. Yet now has He reconciled you. We were enemies. We were against God, but now He's reconciled us by the blood of His cross. We've been joined together with God. We've been made right with God. No longer do we have to worry about, oh God, I failed you today. God, you're not going to accept me anymore. No, the Bible says, come just as you are. Though your sins be as scarlet, I will wash them white as snow. It doesn't matter what you've done, where you've been, it does not matter. If you'll come to the blood of Jesus, there is forgiveness, there is redemption, there is reconciliation in His blood. And when you said yes to Jesus, that's what happened. The blood of Jesus was applied to your heart and to your life, and you were washed from every sin and every stain that you've ever committed. From the time you were born to the time that you said yes to Jesus.
Amen.
And that forgiveness is available all throughout the entirety of your salvation until you make it to glory. Mm. That forgiveness is available for you.
Yeah. Amen.
Chapter 2, verse 10. Paul would tell us that we are complete in the Lord Jesus Christ. Nothing lacking, nothing needing. I don't need anything else. I'm not lacking anything because I'm complete in the Lord Jesus Christ. Everything that God has is found in Jesus Christ. You can read that in verse 19. For it pleased, in verse chapter 1, verse 19. For it pleased God that in Him, in who? In Jesus Christ, should all the fullness of the Godhead bodily dwell. All the fullness of God is in Christ Jesus. And I am complete because I am in the Lord Jesus Christ. When I said yes to the Lord Jesus Christ, God, by the power of the Holy Spirit, like we talked about a minute ago, plucked me up and literally placed me into His Son, Jesus Christ. Into His Son who is righteous and holy and pure. He placed me into the Lamb of God. He placed me into the spotless sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm complete in Him. Nothing lacking. Philippians 4:19, that my God shall supply all of my needs according to His riches and glory, which be by what? By Christ Jesus. So all the riches that God has in glory can be and will be dispensed on my behalf if I will but believe and place my faith in His Son and what His Son has done for me at Calvary's cross. Verse 11, we're circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. When I said yes to Jesus, God went to work on the inner recesses of my heart. He came in to my heart. The moment that I said yes, the moment that I prayed and said, God, forgive me, a sinner. God, cause me to be righteous. God, forgive me, I'm a sinner and I need Your forgiveness. The moment that I said that, God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, came on the inside of my heart with a spiritual scalpel, and He cut away that evilness that was in my heart. He cut away that heart of stone, and He gave me a heart of flesh. Just like Jeremiah would prophesy in Jeremiah chapter 31 or 33, one of the two, he would prophesy that the day is coming when God is going to write His law not on the tablets of stone, but on the inner recesses of the hearts of men and women. Although at that time it seemed impossible because the Spirit of God could not dwell within men and women. It could not happen. It seemed impossible, but Jeremiah prophesied that when this man comes, that he's going to make it available, he's going to make it possible, just like Jesus told His disciples, right now I am with you, but in just a few days I shall be in you. And that's what's happened to you and I. He's come into our hearts. He's circumcised our hearts. He's taken our hearts and He's performed a surgical operation on you and I's hearts, making us acceptable in His sight. Verse 12, we're baptized into Christ's death, His burial, and His resurrection. Verse 12 tells us, buried with Him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with Him through faith of the operation of God who has raised Him from the dead. Going back to Romans 6. By faith, I've been joined together with. When Jesus Christ was crucified, my old man was crucified. When He was placed in the tomb, my old man was placed in the tomb. And when He raised from the dead, my old man did not come out of the tomb. My old man stayed dead and buried in the tomb. And when I came forth from the grave, I came forth as a new man. A new man. Not an old man. I don't have to do the things I used to do, say the things I used to say, go the places I used to go. I don't have to. It's not about, oh, can I or can I? It's not about law or liberalism. It's about the desire that's in my heart, and the new man that lives on the inside of me doesn't want to go where I used to go. The old man, the new man that's on the inside of me doesn't want to do what I used to do. It doesn't want to be what I used to be. Doesn't want to say what I used to say. Doesn't want to sing what I used to sing. Doesn't want to play the things I used to. It doesn't want to do those things anymore. It's not about can I do it or can't I do it. It's about the Spirit of God giving me the desire not to do it. It's not about you. You're free to do what you want to do. That's what Paul said. He said you have a freedom to do all these things, but not all things are expedient. Meaning not all things are beneficial to your salvation. So you better be careful where you're going, what you're saying, what you're watching, what you're listening. You better be careful. But you don't have to set a law on yourself and say, man, I'm not going to do this today. I'm not, because it's not going to work, because you're going to end up doing it again. We're not living by law. I'm talking about living by faith in Christ and the cross and allowing His Spirit to come within our hearts and give us the desires of the Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. To give us the desires of the Spirit. That's pursuing the things of God. That's following. That's seeking after those things which are above.
Thank you, Lord.
It's seeking after, God, give me your desires. Yes. God, give me your heartbeat. There's a song I know we used to sing a few years ago in church. It would say, break my heart for what breaks yours. Everything I am for your kingdom's cause. And that's what it's about. Us receiving, us continually, our hearts being formed into the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, placing His desires on the inside of us. Because if we want to get to a place to where we're pursuing after righteousness, pursuing after holiness, pursuing after all these things, seeking those things which are above. Colossians 3 and 1, the text of our message this morning. If we want to get to a place where we're seeking those things which are above, we've got to know, we've got to have a knowledge of what made available those things that we're seeking. We're seeking, yes, Paul tells us in all in chapter 3, there needs to be holiness in your life. There needs to be righteousness in your life. You need to put away all those things you used to do. You need to stop going to all those places you used to go. But in chapters 1 and 2, he gives us the answers as to how to do that. And that's by placing our faith again. And that's why I'm going over all of this with you this morning. Just as you need a refreshing, I need a refresh. I need to hear this over and over and over and over again. Don't take it lightly, the gospel that you sit under. Don't think that you can come and sit in this church, hear the truth of the gospel, hear the message of the cross, and then go somewhere else next week that's not preaching the fullness of the gospel, that's not pointing you to Jesus Christ and Him crucified, and think that you'll be okay. On the outward, you'll be okay. The enemy will cause you to think that that's okay. But no, week after week, moment after moment, day after day, if you're hearing anything, it needs to be someone pointing you to Jesus Christ and what He's done at the cross.
Amen.
It needs to be a man, woman, boy, or girl, it doesn't matter, whoever it is, but it needs to be somebody pointing your faith to Jesus Christ and Him crucified.
Yes.
And if they're pointing you away from that, or if they're not even fully pointing you to that, then you need to get up, get out of there, and you need to run. Because this gospel is so important that your life literally counts on it. The doctrine that you can read it all throughout the epistles of Paul. Paul emphasizing the need for pure and true doctrine. If you think that you can sit under the message of the cross one service and go to another church the next service, and I'm not talking about churches. I'm not lifting up this church as if, you know, this church is the only church. I'm not saying that. Don't take me in that way. I'm talking about the message that is being preached.
That's right.
And I know Pastor Matt well enough. I love that brother to death. And I know him well enough to know that week after week, he stands behind this pulpit and he points his people to the blood of Jesus. He points his people to the cross of the Lord Jesus Christ. I know Brother Robert, I know Sister Jessica well enough to know that if anybody comes to them and asks them a question, they're going to point someone in the direction of Jesus Christ and what He's done at the cross, because it's the only answer. Don't think that you can mix mix it up, and I can listen to this preacher and that preacher, and like I said, I'm not lifting up one preacher over another. No, but I am lifting up the message of the cross, the message of the blood of Jesus, the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And if that's not what you're hearing on a day-to-day, moment-to-moment basis, then you need to get rid of whatever you're listening to, wherever you're going, whatever you're taking heed to. Y'all understand that? I had a lot of favorite preachers whenever God first slapped me in the head with the message of the cross. Man, I was all into those preachers, man, who they'd get up and sweat and spit, man, and they had big old handkerchiefs and towels, man. And then, you know, I like them black preachers. That's what I like when I was first got saved. But you know what? God had to show me that, hey, it's not about style.
Right.
It's not about how they act. It's not about how loud they can get, how good they... It's not about that. No, it's about the content of what they're saying, of what they're speaking. There's a lot of preachers that can get up here this morning and charisma-wise preach a heck of a lot better than what I can preach this morning. There's a lot of preachers that can get up here with big, deep voices and loud voices, and they can holler and scream and sing and dance and shout. But if they're not preaching the message of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, everything that they are doing is in vain. And God does not honor it. God only honors one thing, one message, one prescribed order of faith and victory, and that is the way of the cross.
Amen.
That is the way of the cross. Jesus Christ, and what God works in no other way but by faith in Christ and what He's done at the cross. I don't know about you, but I want to be a people who not only believe that, but my life is portraying that. It's one thing to simply acknowledge the message of the cross. I know for a long time, especially my whole first year of Bible college, I preached the message of the cross. I'd get up for devotion and I would shout and holler and, you know, I'd rebuke everybody, you know, like I was this paragon, like I was some paragon of righteousness, which God knows I wasn't. But like I was something, you know. And it was because the message of the cross, the knowledge of the truth of the gospel, Paul said this, that knowledge puffs up. So if we're not careful, we can receive a knowledge, a head knowledge of the truth of the gospel, but yet forget to apply it to our hearts and to our lives. Forget to say, God, yes, I understand that You've revealed this to me, but now you've got to make it a part of who I am.
Amen.
You've got to make it real to my heart and to my life. That's two different aspects. It's one thing to have it up here, to know it, but it's got to become who you are. And when it begins to become who you are, you're going to see things in your life falling off. You're not going to want to go the places you used to want to. You're not going to want to do the thing. All those things Paul talks about here in Colossians chapter 3, you can read it. All the things he talks about putting off, to stop lying, stop cheating, stop blaspheming, stop malice and debate, stop debating with everybody, stop fornication, and stop all of these things. You can't do it in and of yourself. You cannot do it. It comes by you continually placing your faith, not just having a knowledge of the message of the cross, but continually placing your faith, Luke 9:23, denying yourself, saying, God, I realize I don't have what it takes. I don't have the power it takes. I realize, Lord, I deny myself today. I take up the cross. I take up the benefits of what Christ has done for me at Calvary's cross, and Lord, I'm going to follow after You. Jesus didn't say just take up the cross and stay stagnant. He didn't say take up the cross and stand there. No, He said take up the cross and follow Him. And He's going to lead you time and time and time and time again back to Calvary. He's going to lead you to His righteousness, to His holiness. We shouldn't, as Christians, we shouldn't look like the world. We shouldn't act like the world. That's not. I'm not talking about us being self-righteous and getting to a place, you know. Past several months, Pastor Keith Babin, he's Pastor Gabriel's associate pastor, he's been ministering, and man, he's ministered some powerful messages talking about this very thing. You know how that, you know, it's very easy for us to claim this message, to claim that we're saved, but are our lives portraying it? You know, are our lives portraying the image of the Lord Jesus Christ? Are our lives producing righteousness and holiness? Is our lives being something that attracts the world? Are we attracting the world? We shouldn't be attracting the world. The only thing that should draw the world to us is the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's it. That's it. Besides that, the world should hate you. The world should want to have nothing to do with you. That's not you being self-righteous. No, I'm talking about when the life of Jesus Christ begins to be manifested in your heart and in your life. Not everybody's church folk, religious folk, they ain't going to like you. Oh, well, you're just self-righteous. No, the power of God has taken up residence in my life, and the power of God is changing me and molding me. You got to tell your brothers and your sisters, hey, I can't listen to that preacher we used to listen to. God, the Holy Ghost is going to convict you of some preachers you've been listening to. He's going to convict you of things you've been watching. Will we ever arrive at a place? No. None of us are perfect. There's things that God, the Holy Ghost, has been trying to get out of my heart for years now. But you know what He's asking me? He's not asking me to get rid of that thing. He's asking me to continue to pursue after Him. Knowing and believing that He is able to change me. Lord. Knowing and believing that He, that He is able to change and to pull out of my life that which does not need to be there. Amen. To pull out of my life that which is not pleasing to Him. To remove those things that I'm not supposed to be involved with. Like I said, over the past couple of weeks, just coming across people that they're quick to say I'm saved, but if they never told me they were saved, I would never know it. Because their lives are no different than the lives of those who are in the world. If they would have never said, yeah, I'm saved, then I would have never known they knew anything about God by the way they acted, by the way they talked, by the things they listened to, by the things they watched. I would have never known. I would have never known. I want my life to so portray the image of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want the life of Christ to be manifested in my heart and life to such a degree that people, I read about Smith Wigglesworth. And I'm closing. Sam, you can come up. Smith Wigglesworth, many of you know that name. You've heard that name. You might have read some of his stuff. God used him to perform some mighty, mighty, mighty miracles over a century ago. Mighty miracles wrought by the hands of Smith Wigglesworth. Of course, it was the power of the Spirit, but anyway. But he would say in some of his writings and some of his books that he would go places, that there was a time that he was taking a train from one place to another. And on this train, he sat down on the train next to another man, a man who was not saved. And he said all of a sudden this man began to weep, and this man began to repent. And he began to ask the Lord, and you know why? It was not because of anything Smith Wigglesworth said. It was because Smith Wigglesworth, the life of Christ was being manifested through his mortal body. Just sitting by this man could feel and sense the presence and the power of God. That's what I want in my heart and in my life. I want to walk into a place, a darkened place, a place that's bound by sin and by the world and by religion. And I want them to immediately know something is different about this young man. Amen. I don't know what it is, but something is different. I want to go places to where I don't even have to speak. And they'll say, something's different about you. Can you tell me what it is?
Yes.
And that's when I need to speak.
Amen.
Now, for those of this, Brother Keith made this say, you can begin to play. Brother Keith made this statement as I was talking about his messages the past few weeks. He made this statement a few weeks ago. He said, and I know he got it from somewhere, but I don't remember where. But he made this statement. He said, if your mouth is speaking the gospel louder than your life is, then you need to be reassessed. You need to say, God, there needs to be a work done in my life. Because our lives should be portraying the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Am I saying this to condemn any of us? No. God forbid, no. Because, hey, God knows I'm not where I need to be. I'm not where I'm supposed to be, and I never will be fully there until the Lord Jesus Christ returns to take me home. I feel the presence of the Lord in this place this morning. But what he wants of me, what he requires of me, is that I pursue, that I seek after. I know I'm not there, But I need to seek after those things which are above, Brother Robert. I need to seek after those things. Seek after righteousness. Seek after holiness. Knowing that the only way it can come about in my heart and in my life, knowing that the only way I can be set free from sin, knowing that the only way that I can truly be separated from the world is through Christ and what He's done for me at the cross. And that's what Pastor Epaphras, this letter, that's what he brought back to the church in Colossae. He brought back a letter that pointed them all back in the first two chapters back to what they had first heard. The gospel of Jesus Christ and Him crucified. And from that point on, basing their faith, basing the foundation of what they were going to do next off of that, they were then able to pursue. They were then able to seek after the kingdom of God, seek after the things which were above. It's only the gospel of Jesus Christ and what He's done at the cross that gives us the power and the availability to see. I want to be changed. I want my life to be an image of righteousness. I want my life to be a literal image of holiness. I want to be so separated like I've never been separated in my life before. I want to be so consecrated to God that I wake up in the morning and it's Jesus. When I go to bed at night, it's Jesus. At lunch, it's Jesus. When I'm at work in the midst of chaos, in the midst of hell itself, it's Jesus. I want my mind to be stayed on Jesus. I want my heart to be fixed on the Lord Jesus Christ. I want my heart to be fixed on the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what I want. I want the holiness of God. Yes. I want the righteousness of God in my family's life.
Yes.
In my friends' life, my brothers and my sisters, I want the righteousness and holiness of God. That's what I long for. I long for it. I want it. I desire it more than I ever have before. I was telling my friend the other day, I said, the past couple of weeks, it's not so much me wanting the presence of God. It's me realizing how much I need the presence of God.
Amen.
It's good to want it. You should want it. But God needs to bring us to a place where we desperately need the presence of God. I need the presence of God. I've got to have it in my life. I can't do without it. I'm too weak. I'm too frail. I've got to have the presence of God in my life. I need the power of the Spirit of God moving and operating in my heart and in my life. I've got to have it. If I'm going to be separate, if I'm going to be the witness that God wants me to be, I've got to have His Spirit. I'm desperate for Him. I need Him more today than I needed Him yesterday. I need You more, Lord. More than words can say, I need You more. Would you stand together?